टुडेज की नोट स्पीकर प्रोफेसर केहर सिंह सर नीड्स फॉर्मल इंट्रोडक्शन टू न्यू कमर्स ओनली. वी कैन कॉल हिम मैन ऑफ ऑप्टिक्स. हिज एरिया ऑफ एक्सपर्टीज इंक्लूड नॉन लीनियर ऑप्टिक्स, सिंगुलर ऑप्टिक्स, होलोग्राफी, इंफॉर्मेशन फोटोनिक्स, इंफॉर्मेशन सिक्योरिटी एंड नैनो फोटोनिक्स. रिसिपियंट ऑफ सेवरल नेशनल एंड इंटरनेशनल अवार्ड्स, author of books like partial differential equation for scientists and engineers. He is from IIT Delhi. I welcome Professor Kehar Singh sir for his talk. Sir.
Welcome to this tutorial presentation on laser speckles. I'll be very selective because the subject is very vast, so I'll give only some bare fundamentals and some selected applications. Just discovery of the world's first laser. We discovered the action in Ruby and air mailed it to Physical Review Letters on June 22, only to be turned down by the editor Goldschmidt. And the reason was that prior to that, Memon had published papers on fluorescence in Ruby, and therefore the editor thought that it's, you know, incremental work. But ultimately, the paper was published in Nature in 1960, and also it was presented, a paper on this was presented, and it was the first report at a scientific conference in Boston in 1960, October. An OSA conference. So coming to the speckles, which is speckle is a random intensity distribution which arises when a frequency transmitted or transmitted from a rough surface falls on a screen. It's visible, in fact, everywhere. And it arises because of the scattering of very elementary waves which are scattered by the rough surface. Another situation in which it can arise is that when the light propagates through a medium with refractive index fluctuations, random refractive index fluctuations. Also, speckle arises in various other parts of the electromagnetic spectrum also. For example, at radar wavelengths, it's called clutter or grass. It also arises in X-ray scattering by liquids, also is scattering of acoustic waves, and electron scattering by amorphous carbon films. But today's talk will be basically concerned. It's not moving. This will be concerned only with the visible laser light scattering. In mathematics, a similar problem arises in what is known as Rayleigh's drunkard's walk. So supposing you have a person who is heavily drunk and he starts walking, takes certain steps, there will be no correlation between the successive steps with the earlier ones. And then what are the chances of finding him at the place from which he started, or at the point from which he started? So Rayleigh tried to answer this question, and his answer was that the chances of finding him at a place from where he started are maximum. It does not mean that he will always be found there, but chances are maximum. So it's a statistical problem. And he investigated this in three dimensions, a general case. Two-dimensional, one-dimensional cases will be, of course, particular cases. And his result was that it's a negative exponential probability distribution function. In Brownian motion, a similar problem arises. In atmospheric turbulence also, it arises. So if you take a short exposure photograph of light coming from a star, it's not a regular pattern. You have various dots, random dots. So that is a spectrum. When you shine a laser beam onto a wall, which is rough on the scale of wavelength of light, it appears as if the ants were rolling. And that is because of the motion of your eyes. Otherwise, it will appear to be static. It looks like salt and pepper appearance. And for those who are familiar with the novel on speckle bands by Sir Arthur Conan Doyle, these are like the spots that you see on the snake's skins. Historically, Newton first investigated the problem, and I'll come to this a little later. Now, of course, there are very large number of books on the subject. It's a very mature subject. When I started my investigations on laser speckles way back in 1966 or so, there were hardly a few papers, publications. But now there are several thousands of them, in fact. History is very interesting. In fact, in the later part of the 19th century, when Newton investigated these were called Newton's diffusion rings. The students are familiar with Newton's rings, where both the waves which take part in interference are regular waves. That means not a scattered one. But if one of the waves is a regular wave and another is a scattered wave, then you do get some rings which are diffused, somewhat diffused. And these are called Newton's diffusion rings or Quetelet's fringes. And in the book that I mentioned, Optics by Newton, there is a mention of these. In 1877, a scientist called Exener made a sketch of this radial granular structure in which he used a candle light as a source and took a glass plate on which he breathed, and that provided the scattering centers. Then in 1916, von Laue obtained this diffraction pattern by a plate which was covered with the lycopodium powder, and he used a carbon arc as a lamp to illuminate this plate using 420 to 430 nanometer region of the spectrum. In 1943, an Indian scientist named G.N. Ramachandran investigated this problem. And the beauty was that he made visual observations of the speckle pattern. There was no laser at that time, of course. So he used a mercury source with a filter. So the light was partially coherent, and even partially coherent light would, of course, give the speckles. But he selected a very small portion of the spectrum. So he did get a curve, which is a negative exponential. And the beauty of this curve is that his observations of intensity were visual. That means he estimated the intensities visually. Whereas later on, it was proved that by taking very large number of measurements. I think 23,000 measurements at Imperial College, somebody proved this negative expansion law. So on the y-axis, you plot the probability of finding a speckle between intensity I and I plus delta I. Delta I is a small increment. And on x-axis, you plot the average intensity. So the intensity divided by the average intensity seen divided by the average intensity. Sir C.V. Raman also dabbled in the investigations on this topic. And he used, in fact, a glass plate on which some milk was put, and it was kept in a hanging position, providing scattering centers. And in this case, of course, there was some movement of the speckles, and he published these results in 1999. He also postulated, in fact, that when you look at a distant light source, you see some streaks, and these are because of the scattering in the scatterers that are present in the visual system, ocular media. Speckle was called enemy number one by the originator of holography, Professor D. Gerber. And this is because of the fact that the object of whose you are recording a hologram scatters light, which interferes with the reference beam, and the interference of these two is called the hologram. But please do not forget that the object scatters light from various points, and these scattered waves also interfere among themselves, besides interfering with the reference beam. So it's the interference of these waves among themselves which creates this random distribution of intensity. And when you reconstruct the image from the hologram, these speckles act as scattering centers, and therefore the image gives you a speckled appearance. It's never perfectly smooth. So this is one of the disadvantages of using high coherence, in fact. Similar problem arises in interferometry also. So if you do an experiment with a Michelson interferometer, and instead of using, let's say, mercury source or a sodium source, which you normally use in your BSc classes, if you use lasers, and if the mirrors of the mirrors and beam divider of the Michelson interferometer are not very clean, even if the instrument by mistake leaves a thumbprint on one of the mirrors, you will see the fringes, which are not very regular fringes. You will see the scattered light superimposed on these fringes. And therefore, speckle has to be suppressed in many of the situations. For example, in holography, in multimode fiber images, or image formation using multimode fibers, in projection displays using lasers these days, and in optical coherence tomography, which is so widely used for examining the visual system, and now it has, of course, entered in the field of dermatology. There are ways to reduce the effect of the speckle so that the resolution is improved. So you can do this by polarization diversity, by temporal averaging. So put a moving diffuser in front of the source. You can do it by wavelength and angle diversity, by temporal and spatial coherence reduction, and observing the pattern through a finite diffuser. So there are a number of methods. But you can put this speckle pattern to use. And the reason is that when the light is scattered by an object, by a rough object, the light carries the information regarding the object. So the object is vibrating, light carries information about it. If the object is rough, the scattered light conveys information, carries information about this, and so on and so forth. So as Benjamin Franklin said to poor Richard, in one of his talks, eliminate that which is bothersome, and your work shall be the better for it. But find a use for that which offends thee, and thou shalt be twice rewarded. So normally spackle is a nuisance, but there are many applications in which spackle becomes very, very useful, and I'll come to these now. But before that, spackles can be of various types. So there are various ways of classifying spackles. It can be static or it can be dynamic. If it's from a moving object, it can be dynamic on a short time scale. It can be monochromatic or it can be polychromatic. It can be Gaussian, non-Gaussian, objective or subjective, fully developed or partially developed, real field or virtual field. I'll touch upon some of these, not all. So for example, on the left hand side of your screen, you see what is known as Gaussian speckle. It's called speckle, Gaussian, because of the fact that the real and the imaginary parts of the complex amplitude of the scattered light have a probability distribution which is Gaussian, and that's why it's called Gaussian. Statistically speaking, if you take a small area of this pattern, you cannot distinguish it from some other part, portion of the slide. Whereas in non-Gaussian, the properties vary from area to area. So this is one of the classifications. When you talk of objective and subjective speckles, in case of objective speckle, let's say the light transmits or is transmitted through the diffuser or is diffusely reflected from the diffuser, and these scattered waves interfere, let's say at one point in this case, although there are many waves and they will interfere at various places on the screen, but you take one of the points. So depending upon the phase difference between these two waves, you will have constructive or destructive interference. And in this case, it's only the property of the diffuser, its roughness and the area which is illuminated, and of course the wavelength of illumination, which will decide the speckle properties. Whereas in the figure down below, it's called objective speckle. So in this case, there is a lens which captures these scattered light beams. Let's say gives you a speckle in a small area within the spread function of the optical system, lens in this case. And in this case, in addition to the illuminating wavelength, the surface, the properties of the lens also come into the picture. So let's say the F number or any large amount of aberration in the system, these will also decide the distribution of these spectra. So the same thing is illustrated in this slide also, except that the surface roughness has been exaggerated. So in objective speckle, that means in the figure down below, there are waves coming from different points or different scatterers in the object, and they give rise to the diffraction patterns at various points in the image plane, and these diffraction patterns then overlap. I'm talking the amplitude diffraction patterns, which of course you cannot see, you can see only the intensity diffraction patterns. So these amplitude diffraction patterns are coherent with respect to each other. These interfere and then give you the intensity pattern, which is random. So this is the way the speckle pattern arises. I'll talk about a very, very simple case. This, in fact, the simplest case that you can think of, in which there's perfectly coherent illumination and perfectly polarized light, and the elementary scattering areas are unrelated, and the strength of the given scattered components bears no relation to the phase. Daddy. And phases are uniformly distributed in the interval 0 to 2 pi or minus pi to pi, which means that the surface is rough compared to a wavelength of light. So this is the simplest case that you can think of. In this case, the probability distribution PII is given with this expression 1 upon I average and this exponential function. So the probability of finding intensity I between I and plus a small increment delta I is given by this. So what does it mean? It means that the dark speckles, perfectly dark speckles, are most probable. And repeat it. This is the main result. Perfectly dark speckles, perfectly black speckles, are most probable. And then the intensity decreases exponentially. So very, very bright speckles are far and very small. So in this case, we can apply central limit theorem. If you assume that the number of scatterers is very large, tends to infinity. The central limit theorem of the statistics says that the statistics of the sum of n independent variables is Gaussian as n tends to infinity. So it's because of the application of this theorem that you simplify the calculations and come out with a curve like this. Such a curve in case of laser speckles was first given by Joseph Goodman in 1975. So on the y-axis you can see that the probability of finding the darkest speckle, that means your zero point, is maximum, and then the intensity decreases according to this negative exponential law. And when the intensity is about, let's say, four times that of the average intensity, where the curve has a very, when the intensity is a very, very small value, intensity is four times the average value, the probability is very, very small. And then asymptotically, it goes down to zero. This result was actually proved in 1975 by McGatney at Imperial College of London for his thesis, for his PhD thesis. And he made about 23,000 observations and proved that is actually negative exponential. Before that, it was only theoretically derived. So recall the result by Ramachandran, who also proved it experimentally, but only by taking a few observations visually. And at that time, he did not have access to processing of the results electronically. So that was the first order statistics. There is something called second order statistics, in which you can have autocorrelation and power spectrum as the two main functions. Autocorrelation gives you about the information about the average size of the speckle, because the speckles have random intensity distribution, but their sizes are not the same. Some speckles are smaller in size as compared to the others. So you have to talk of an average size. The average size is given by the zero of this autocorrelation function. And the Fourier transform of this intensity distribution autocorrelation of the intensity distribution is the power spectrum, which you can see in the figure down below. Now coming to some of the applications, you can do interferometry with the speckles to measure vibrations, displacements, deformations, thermal changes in an object, and so on and so forth. And this is a very simple interferometer which was described by one of my co-workers in 1970 in UK, published in 1970. So on the left hand side you can see the object wave coming through a polarizer and a lens, striking a beam splitter, which is a wedge beam splitter, and going to an objective lens, and finally to, of course, the eye of the observer. The reference beam comes perpendicular to this, is reflected from the beam divider, and interferes with the object beam, giving rise to speckles, which you can see visually. The function of the rotating polaroid is actually to adjust the intensities of the object and reference beam for optimum result. So this very good instrument for visual observations before doing holography. Holography is more precise to measure vibrations, but speckle interferometry is very easy to perform. I'm talking of simplest type of speckle interferometer. So these days these are very advanced forms of interferometers which can give you sensitivity as good as that of the holographic technique. So you have a metal plate which is stationary and vibrating, stationary in the diagram above and vibrating in the diagram below. So you can see some nodes and antinodes. So this is good for visual observations. You can also have speckle correlation fringes in which you have basically a Michelson interferometer type of arrangement. So the light reflected from a regular mirror and light reflected from a scattering object. That can give you correlation fringes shown down below. As I said earlier, the speckles convey information about the they carry information about the surface roughness also. So you have two photographs here, A and B. A is for a ground glass where the average roughness is, RMS value of the roughness is 1.3 micron. Whereas for B, the average, the RMS roughness is 0.20 micron. So you can see that in A, the contrast is very good. Whereas in B, it's not so good. Now, what it means is that you can measure the surface roughness of an object by studying the statistical properties of the speckle. And this can be done now having access to data processing techniques by making measurements on these speckle patterns using a CCD and then processing the data. In the old times, it was done, of course, by using photographic techniques. You can measure very small linear displacements. So on the left hand side, you have fringes which are closely spaced as compared to those on the right hand side. So in this case, the displacement is of the order of a few microns. On the left hand side, the displacement is larger as compared to displacement on the right hand side. You can measure vibrations. In this case, this is time average speckle pattern of a harmonically oscillating object on the left hand side and a continuously moving object on the right hand side, object moving with continuous velocity. You can make measurements on tilts. So you have the various orientations and various separations of the various separations of the fringes. Using correlation techniques, you can have information on a bar in which there is a hole drilled and that there is a stress pattern produced. You can observe disbonding by thermal stressing. In this case, it's automotive clutch plate that is actually bonded to a steel substrate. And in the figure down below, it is cylindrical uranium fuel element with an aluminum outer plating that is actually bonded to a steel core. There's a whole branch of astronomy called speckle astronomy these days. You can observe distant stars using this technique without the atmospheric turbulence playing any role. In normal telescope observations, your figure is very much degraded because of the turbulence, and ultimately the resolution is limited by this atmospheric turbulence effect. So, as I said earlier, a short-term photograph of a star which sends light through turbulent atmosphere comes out in the form shown in this diagram, in this photograph. So these are speckles, and that's why actually you say twinkle twinkle little star, because the path of the light is changed randomly because of this turbulence effect. So this is a laboratory simulation which was performed way back in 1975 by a person, by a French astronomer called Lambert, who later on actually implemented the technique in an astronomical, real astronomical observatory. So in the first row, you see some objects like one disk, then two disks separated by a larger distance, and then a bigger disk, single bigger disk. Short exposure photographs of these are given in second row. Diffraction patterns of these photographs in the second row are given in the third row. As I said earlier, this is a laboratory simulation. To improve the signal to noise ratio, which is very poor in the diffraction patterns, you take the sum of 20 such diffraction patterns. More the better, in fact, but in this case it was 20. So you can see that the fringes have started appearing. In the second one, in fact, you can see the fringes very prominently. So these are fringes due to two stars. And if you take the diffraction pattern of the patterns in the third row, then you can see the objects. So in the first case, you see the small disk. In the second case, you can see two disks around the zero order diffraction pattern on both sides of the diffraction pattern. In the third one, you see two disks separated by a larger distance. And in the last one, you see a larger disk. The speckle optometers to measure the refraction error of the eye, and these can be used for mass screening of the children and illiterate subjects, illiterate people who cannot read, in fact, the Snellen test chart, which is used by the optometrists. Night myopia and instrument myopia were first explained on the basis of spectral optometry, especially using spectral techniques. Night myopia is a very interesting phenomenon. Without any pathological reason, at night, the eye becomes myopic, which means that if the illumination is very, very good, you see all right, but the moment you go to a dimly lit place, in a street, for example, your eye becomes myopic. Similarly, there is instrument myopia. You look through a microscope, and if the level of illumination is not very good, you have to readjust your focus to see the object clearly. So driving at night on highways which are poorly lit can be dangerous. And it's said, in fact, by the Road Safety Council of USA in its report, that many of the accidents take place because of this. So the level should be illumination of level. Sorry, level of illumination should be right. There is also a hypothesis which is called intermediate state of accommodation, which was verified for the first time. This hypothesis says that in the relaxed condition, the eye is not focused for infinity. It's focused for a distance which is finite, though large, and it has some ramifications in some observations. So the principle of this optometer is very simple. For a normal eye, you can see that if you have a speckle pattern being formed by a scatter, and you have the light ray, in this case, to simplify things, I'm calling it ray, IJ, being focused on your retina at point F and another axial ray coming from O, then you are a person with normal eye because the light is being focused on your retina. Okay. Whereas in case of a myopia, these two rays will cross each other away from F on the left hand side. I'll show that picture. But if you move this, so in the second picture, you see that the J has come below O. That means if you have a moving screen, the light will still be focused at F for a normal eye person. Whereas for myopic eye, now the focus will be at point F. So the ray IJ will go to point A on the screen. In your case, in fact, it's your retina. In the second figure, in the middle figure here, because of the moving screen, the point J has come below O. And in this case, IJ, ray depicted by IJ, is focused at a point A on the screen. So the point A, the first figure, moves up. Earlier it was below the axis, now it moves up the axis, on the upper side of the axis. So by observing the movement of the speckles, you can know whether you are myopic, or in the third figure, there's a way to test whether you are hypermetropic. So in this case, the light is focused behind the retina, and if point J moves to a point below O, or at a place below O, the point A is below the axis now. So the movement of the speckles will be downwards, whereas in the previous case, the movement of the speckle was upwards. In actual practice, actually, in the instrument, you will see it the other way around, because the retina reverses the directions. So far, I was talking of actually the static object. There is a whole field of speckles, a very large number of applications. For example, you can study the drying of paints, you can study the germination of seeds, you can see the ripening of fruits and the growth of plants, you can see skin perfusion. You can observe retina blood flow, and it has applications in neurology. For example, the headache caused because of the migraine has been studied. Stroke has been studied using this. And there is a very good book that I recommend to you, to anybody who gets interested in the subject. It's called Dynamic Laser Speckle and Applications. It gives an extremely large number of applications, and this is the field these days, actually, which is very, very active. Okay, so with this, I'll sign off, and I've written a quotation: "A wise man can learn more from a foolish question than a fool can learn from a wise answer." So thank you very much for being such patient listeners. I don't think the organizers will permit a question answer session because of the lag of time, because of paucity of time. So in the future, if I get an opportunity for a long